So let's go over some pathologies. So these three pathologies you should look for actively: bone marrow edema, effusion, and synovitis. So if some patient comes with pain, he probably has one of these three things. Okay, these meniscal tears can cause pain, this stuff can cause pain, but that's usually because these things get irritated. Okay, somebody got contused, he has bone marrow edema, he's symptomatic out of that. Somebody has effusion, now he has active synovitis, he became symptomatic. Okay, larger the effusion is, more symptomatic they are. So these are the things you should look for when you're initially evaluating these images. And when you look at marrow, first you have to decide, you know, is it normal marrow I'm looking at it? Is it abnormal marrow, or is it just a variation like a red marrow reconversion? Okay? So that's the first thing before you go into these small structures. You may be missing a big fracture, you're looking for a small meniscal tear. Okay? So when you see edema, more on the T2 weighted images or the fat saturated images, less on the non-fat saturated images, disproportionate. Think of more benign things. Okay? It may be just a fracture with a lot of edema, which is more on T2 weighted images. It may be a contusion. While if it starts appearing more on the T1 weighted images, more darkness, think bad. Okay, it could be a lymphoma or leukemia, it could be infection, those kind of things. Okay. So let's see some examples. So this is how a normal knee will appear. You know, there is fatty marrow which suppresses, and you can have some islands of red marrow which may be left around. Usually people convert to all this yellow marrow by 20s and 30s, and only red marrow, maybe residual, will be in metaphysis. Okay, epiphysis and apophysis, like tibial tuberosity, will not have any red marrow. Okay, they should be white. Or sometimes you get like this. Okay, it looks ugly, right? There's a lot of marrow signal change here, which is bright on T2 weighted images or fat saturated images. So you start thinking bad. But then, what your clue is, you compare this to the muscles. If it's brighter than the muscle on a T1 weighted images, you're fine. Okay. That means it has fat within it, it's a benign red marrow. If it's darker than the muscle or iso to muscle, you start worrying. Okay. Then you look at other stuff. So here's another case. Looks pretty ugly, right? A lot of marrow change, signal change, minimally bright here. So if again you compare with the muscles, so if you compare this versus this, so this is a little brighter. Okay. If that doesn't reassure you, you can go on the other images. So you can do in and out of phase images, like you do for adrenal, look for small islands of fat. Or you can look at plain films. With this much marrow, there should be plain film changes. Sometimes not, but you look for that. But a simple thing you can do is you can go to the scout images. Okay, these are the scout images. These are gradient echo images. These are technically out of phase images. And if it's a normal marrow, it's gonna suppress out. So it's black, so you don't worry about that. Okay, and obviously the plain film is normal. Again, looks ugly, right? A lot of patches, even go into the epiphysis. Okay, so again, brighter than the muscle. And then again, you look on your plain films, they're normal. You look at the scout image, it's black. Okay, so you're fine. All right, so I've taught this to various fellows, residents, and still some of the fellows come back. And actually, I was on the phone and I was talking to them, you know, did you look at the scout? Did you look, you know, go back and see if it's brighter than the muscle or not on T1 weighted images? So simple rules, follow them and they'll help you. Okay. And here is a case where you have a line. Okay. If you look at, there's a lot of edema on the T2 weighted images, fat suppressed. If you look back on the T1 weighted or a non-fat saturated image, there's not much happening except for this fracture line, very little signal on T1 weighted images. Okay. So we are thinking more of benign. Okay. More of a reactive edema rather than a real infiltration of the marrow. So here there's a fracture at the ACL foot plate. Okay. Another case, lot of edema, a lot of fascial edema with that. Okay, so something is happening there. Look on T1 weighted images, there is this crescentric line, so that's a fracture there. Okay, so there is a little fracture there, very little signal on T1. Okay, so that's basically a reactive edema, more on T2 or more on fat saturated versus non-fat saturated. And more you have process in the marrow, more edema you'll have. Okay, more you have process in the cortex or the periosteum, there will be less edema. So this is another one. You see, from here to here, this is all edema. Okay, it should be black, so white. So a lot of edema. And if you look on, I didn't show you T1, but T1 was almost negative. And if you look carefully, there's a fracture. Okay. So these are longitudinal stress fractures. They go along the length of the cortex. Okay, you can have transverse fractures also. So you can have a fracture which goes like this in a long segment and creates a lot of edema. Okay, so we are thinking benign. Here's an ACL graft which has mucoid degeneration, and due to that there's edema there. And if you look on the non-fat side, there's nothing there. So you don't worry about that. That's just a post-op change. Okay. Here's another one, ACL graft, lot of T1 signal, lot of T2 signal, almost proportionate. So this was infection. Okay. So when you start seeing problem on T1 or a non-fat saturated, start worrying. Here's another one. So in this case, there's a multilobular lesion. Okay. Goes to the physeal scar. So this was also infection, and you can see a lot of edema there, effusion, a lot of T1 signal. Okay. And then the other thing is, now we saw the red marrow, we saw the normal marrow, we saw the benign versus malignant lesions. Then if you have focal lesions like this, which are darker than muscle, so we know it's not red marrow, and we look on T2, it's pretty bright, it's lobulated. What lesion is this? Pretty common. Enchondroma, right? Lobulated, very bright. This is cartilaginous matrix, close to the physeal scar. So these are believed to be displaced cartilage pieces from the physeal scar which form these lesions, okay? They're less than a centimeter, we refer to them cartilage rests because they're so common. More than a centimeter, then we say it's enchondroma, okay? So here you have a cortical lesion. It's basically osteochondroma getting out with a cartilage gap. Again, not much edema, nothing happening, right? It's a cortical lesion. And here you have a subcortical lesion, but you have a lot of periosteal reaction here. Okay, a lot of periosteal reaction, associated bone marrow edema, fascial edema. So when you have these kind of lesions, what are these? It could be a fracture with periosteal reaction. It could be a lesion in the cortex. So this was osteoid osteoma. Okay. So again, a lot of edema here. Not much signal change on the T1. So we're thinking of benign lesions. Okay, this is osteoid osteoma. And in this case, you commonly see that on the lateral aspect of the medial femoral condyle, a little osteochondral lesion. Okay, in a young patient, we call it osteochondritis dissecans. Okay, to the lucency around it, unstable fragment. Okay, and over time, it loses. So in these cases, again, edema will be just localized to that area, because again, it's a cortical subcortical lesion just in that area. And that's another cortical lesion you should remember: thickening of the cortex. On T2 it images all the infiltration in the cortex. Okay, so what is that? Pagets, right? So this is that blade of grass on the nuke scan, blade of grass. Okay, very sharp margin engineered. Usually when you have long lesions, think benign. Okay, when you have long bizarre lesions, think of pagets, think of fibrodysplasia, think of neurofibromatosis. Those are the three main categories for long bizarre lesions like this. Okay, we are not thinking malignant here. And here is an example where you see this lucency, right? Classic metaphyseal lucency. And on the MR, there's infiltration of the marrow and there's infiltration of the soft tissues, but the cortex seems preserved. Okay? So when you see this appearance, what are we thinking? Some sort of a round cell tumor, okay, which basically permeated out, leukemia, lymphoma, all that. So now in these cases, if you look on T1 weighted images, you'll have a lot of signal change. Okay? So the marrow will be bright on T2. On T1 or a non-fat side, it will be dark, okay, because it's a marrow process getting out. Here's another marrow process, okay. So quite a bit of dark signal on T1, quite a bit of dark signal, bright signal on T2, almost proportional, okay. So what could give you that? So two main things you should be thinking here, okay. It could be a fracture, but that'll give you very little T1 signal. But there are two main things. One is lymphoma, one is medullary infarcts, okay. So they will give you similar appearance. And these are the classic infarcts. T1 dark, I told you this sequence, you can see in the background of fat, dark lesions, so avascular necrosis, bright on T2, almost symmetrical, okay, benign. And here is a classic avascular necrosis with all these double layers, okay? Granulation tissue and creeping substitution, all you read in pathology. But this is a very classic appearance, bone infarct, has fat within it. It has double layers, okay? All right, so that's enough with marrow. So when we're looking at the marrow, you have to decide it's normal, it's red marrow, it's pathologic marrow. If it's pathologic, are we thinking benign? Are we thinking malignant based on T1 and fat saturated signals? Okay, if you're thinking malignant, where we can pinpoint? Is it in the cortex, subcortical area, marrow, all that stuff? Okay, so there'll be separate lectures on tumors. I'll be taking one on how to call something benign and not scare the patient. So we'll take all those lectures. But basically, just keeping putting something in your minds, you know, look at the marrow first when you're looking at all these joints. Okay, yeah.
Do you pay attention to the trabeculation in areas where you have low T1 signal? as an indicator of benignity?
That's useful in x-rays, usually not on MRs. Because MRs are very sensitive, even you can pick up small stuff. So you could have leukemic infiltrates in between the trabeculations. Those will be still preserved. That helps you. For me, trabeculations help me to decide whether if I see a deformity or a lesion in the bone, I'm thinking developmental or acquired. Because I know if it's developmental, bone is deformed, but the trabeculations will be there. If it's something acquired, trauma, infection, fracture, tumor, something happened, the trabeculation will be destroyed. So it's acquired stuff. So that's where it helps me. Okay. All right, so you have these macros for all these MRs, right? You have to fill in. When you go to these MR rotations, effusion, present, absent, synovial proliferation, present, absent, plica there or not there, you know, things like that. So the first thing is effusion. So I've seen people overcalling effusion a lot. So you should know what the criteria is. Okay, I don't always measure it, but you should know the criteria. So in the middle section, if the fluid or the suprapatellar pouch is more than 5 millimeter in thickness, okay, the AP dimension, or laterally if it's more than 10 millimeters, transverse dimension. Okay, then you call effusion. Okay, so there is no effusion here. This small effusion here, more than 5 millimeter. Okay, this is moderate, and this is large. Okay, so in moderate effusion, you distend all the recesses. Here, the recesses are still sort of collapsed. Okay, it's just a little bit of effusion. So moderate effusion, and then large effusion. Okay, and then obviously you can look for fluid levels. This is hematocrit level. So it's a hemarthrosis. Okay. The other thing is plica. So what are plica? So when I came here, there was a macro which said plica present or absent. Okay, plica is always present. Why? Because the knee joint is formed by various recesses. And then they fuse, and those remnants are the plica. Okay, so every knee has plica. Now the question is whether they are thickened or they are not thickened. So that's important. Okay, so you know the location of plica. So there are four plica. Okay, superior, inferior, medial, lateral. Easy to remember. So superior always forms this suprapatellar pouch. Okay, sometimes you can have a thick plica and you can have isolated effusions above the plica sitting there, which can present as a mass. Inferior plica goes to the Hoffer's fat pad like that, okay, in this area. So I showed you a normal one where you see a little bit of signal there. But in this case, this is a lot of signal. See that? So this is called sprained ligamentum mycosum or sprain of the inferior plica. Same thing. And sometimes you can see tears of these. So in this case, it's torn. When you see fluid outpouchings like that in the Hoffer's fat pad, a lot of edema, so that's a torn plica. Okay. And then you have medial and lateral. So with ACL injuries, a lot of times you'll get shearing injury to the Hoffer's fat pad. It's pretty common to get these plica injuries. Okay. So here again, it's a sprain of ligamentum mycosum as it goes through that. In this case, you don't see it. You see fractures of the Hoffer's fat pad. Okay. All these contours. So the plica is not going to be there, right? So you can safely make a diagnosis of torn PF plica. Now, you'll commonly see in cases of effusion, slight effusion passing through that. But that shouldn't give you edema, number one. And number two, patient has other things happening. If patient comes with anterior knee pain, nothing else is happening, and you see edema in this area of ligamentum mycosum, that's a diagnosis. That can be symptomatic by itself. Okay. The other thing is synovial proliferation. This is a sign of internal derangement. Any knee which is deranged internally will over time, the synovium will proliferate, it will hypertrophy, and these are three examples. So here you see these fronds. So the joint capsule is like pleura and peritoneum. It shouldn't have any thickening. Okay, it should be thin linear line. When you see a site, it should be clearly outlined. Same, when you see effusion here, it shouldn't have these thickenings. So this is mild synovial proliferation, this is getting into moderate, all these fronds. Okay, when you give contrast, some of these may enhance. And then this is kind of moderate to severe, see that? So a lot of synovial proliferation. Now this synovial proliferation over time can become fatty also. Okay, you can have fibrofatty proliferation. And some people name it lipoma arborescence, which can be partial or complete, but it means the same thing. It's a synovium proliferating, it's a fat proliferating, okay? So if you see that in a kid where this is the only isolated abnormality, then I use the term lipoma arborescence, okay? Where I have to go in and do synovectomy. In adults, when they get this much derangement, everybody has some portions of fat which are suppressing out. You know, this is all fat which has proliferated. So secondary lipoma arborescence, if you would say that, that's pretty common.